Let's pray. Lord God, we come to you this morning as those who desperately need you. And we invite you, Lord, by the power of your Holy Spirit, to open up our minds and our hearts to your word, that you would touch us, that you would set us free. And Lord, I pray that you would let me get out of the way, that you would speak to us. In Jesus' name, amen. Please be seated. You know, as I remembered or thought about the scene from our Old Testament reading this morning from Ezekiel 37, I was reminded of some of the more gruesome and dramatic battle scenes that I've seen in movies. Scenes that were absolute carnage to the extent that it really was overwhelming to even watch it on the big screen. I remember the battle scenes from Braveheart and Lord of the Rings, the Battle of Helm's Deep, or the opening scene to Gladiator. These were scenes where the loss of life was just devastating. And it created something within you as you watched it, this sense of the horror of war. Or perhaps you've seen pictures of bodies that were stacked up or thrown into open graves at some of the prison concentration, Nazi concentration camps in World War II. And had been revolted by the horror and the sadness that such a thing could happen. And although this is not quite what confronted Ezekiel when in his vision of the valley of dry bones, it would have been to him equally repulsive. As a priest, he would not have been able to touch the bones or anything that was dead. It would have defiled him. And yet God in the Spirit leads him not just to this valley, but in and through this valley, that he might see the two things that God wants him to see about them. And the first is that there are enough skeletons to make up an exceedingly great army. You see that in verse 10. Showing that this had been a battle scene where thousands upon thousands of people had died. And secondly, the bones were very dry, which means they've been there for a long time. The birds and the animals have picked them clean, and the sun has bleached them white. And there's no way to recognize the individuals that they once were. They're just dry bones in a valley. What would have been very disturbing to Ezekiel as well was the fact that they were unburied, which is the idea of having your corpse not buried in the ancient Near East culture was you have been condemned. Proper burial was not just for the sake of the family or friends, but it was to not be buried was considered a guarantee that you would have constants of suffering in the afterlife. It was a sign of ultimate humiliation to Israel, and it was a sign of God's judgment for disobedience. In Deuteronomy 28, 25, and 26, God warned Israel against turning away from his commands. He says, "The Lord will cause you to be defeated before your enemies. You shall go out one way against them and flee seven ways before them. You shall be a horror to all the kingdoms of the earth, and your dead bodies shall be food for all the birds of the air and for the beasts of the earth, and there shall be no one to frighten them away." These bones were not just evidence that the victims had died in battle, but they were evidence that they had fallen under divine judgment. And so God then turns to Ezekiel and he says, "Son of man, can these bones live?" I can't imagine what went through Ezekiel's mind when God asked him that. I mean, certainly the answer would seem to be, well, no, absolutely not. There was nothing to restore. There was only bones. He was most likely familiar with the stories of Elijah and Elisha, where people had died and they went to their bodies and they prayed and God raised them up. But these were bodies that were not long dead. And what God's asking him, can these bones who have been here a long time be resurrected? But I suspect that Ezekiel is also assuming that God had asked this question for a very good reason. And so really his answer to the Lord is quite brilliant. Oh Lord God, you know. That's a great answer, isn't it? Ezekiel knew that Yahweh was not like the gods of other nations who were no gods at all. That he was the Lord God who was the creator God, who had authority over life and over death. One of the earliest poems in the Hebrew Bible was Deuteronomy 32:39. It says, "See now that I, even I, am He, and there is no God beside me. I kill and I make alive. I wound and I heal. And there is none that can deliver out of my hand." Or remember Psalm 104:29-30. "When you hide your face, they are dismayed. When you take away their breath, they die and return to their dust. When you send forth your spirit, they are created, and you renew the face of the ground." Ezekiel would have known that it was certainly within the power of God to revive the dead, but these are still dry bones. But his answer leaves room for God to act according to his power. But it would not be because Ezekiel had the faith to believe something like that could happen. But it's at this point that God speaks again, and he's asking Ezekiel to do something. He's asking him to act in faith by speaking the words that God lays upon him. "And then he said to me, 'Prophesy over these bones and say to them, O dry bones, hear the word of the Lord.'" Now think for a minute what God is saying here. I mean, as far as I know, bones don't have ears. I mean, ears have bones, but not the other way around. Right, Doug? It's a doctor here. He certified that. Then again, it's God who's commanding. I mean, this is very different than the other times when God had sent Ezekiel out to confront those who were hard-hearted or stiff-necked or in rebellion to God. They were there. They were alive. And he could go and speak that word of God and hope for a reaction. But these were bones. But then God instructs him not just to speak, but tells him what to say. "Thus says the Lord God to these bones, behold, I will cause breath to enter you and you shall live. And I will lay sinew upon you and will cause flesh to come upon you and cover you with skin and put breath in you. And you shall live and you shall know that I am the Lord." So Ezekiel chooses obedience to the command of God. He spoke the very same words that God gave him. No incantations, no special ceremony. Just a simple command that God had told him to speak to the bones, causing the most amazing thing to happen right in front of him. The living power of the word of the living God, who rules with all power and authority over all things, over the universe, enters into the valley of the shadow of death and brings transformation to dry bones. There's the sound again of bones coming together in such a way as they fit perfectly, but the bones that needed to come to the right bones, and then sinew, and then flesh, and then skin covers the bones, but there was still a problem. They're now covered with flesh, but there's no breath in them. No life, no movement. They're still lifeless corpses. And if something doesn't happen, then the vultures are going to be back for dinner again. And then Yahweh speaks for the third time and commands the prophet to once more speak in obedience to his command. He says, "Prophesy to the breath, prophesy, son of man, and say to the breath, thus says the Lord God, come from the four winds, O breath, and breathe on these slain that they may live. And so I prophesied as he commanded me. And the breath came into them, and they lived and stood on their feet, an exceedingly great army." It's important to note here that the Hebrew word for breath is the same word used for wind and for spirit. Like in verses 1 and 14 where God uses the word spirit. As a matter of fact, this word is used 10 times in our passage. It's very significant. At the beginning and the end of our section, it refers to the Spirit of God who at first lifts up Ezekiel and takes him into the valley. And then towards the end, it's this same Spirit that brings back to life and restores them and gives them back what they had lost, back to their own land. Why? So they would know that He was God. In verses 5, 6, 8, and 10, it literally means breath, like needing breath to breathe. But in verse 9, it has a dual function. It's the word for breath, but towards when it says, "Come from the four winds, O breath, and breathe on those slain that they may live," it's actually referring to the Spirit of God being called upon. The Spirit of God who comes from all places. And this breath causes, imparts life to slain corpses. They come to life again. It's just like in the very beginning in Genesis. It was the Spirit of God who breathed life into Adam, who was made from the dust, but he was just inanimate. He was there, but there was no life until the breath of God is breathed into his nostrils. And so here, Ezekiel's vision, the life-giving power of the Creator once more breathes life into the lifeless bodies, and once more there's this miracle of new existence. And finally, in verses 11 to 14, the whole point of this vision is made clear. And he said to me, "Son of man, these bones are the whole house of Israel. Behold, they say our bones are dried up and our hope is lost, and we are indeed cut off. Therefore prophesy and say to them, thus says the Lord God, behold, I will open your graves and raise you from your graves, O my people. And I will bring you into the land of Israel, and you shall know that I am the Lord when I open your graves and raise you up from your graves, O my people. And I will put my Spirit within you, and you shall live. And I will place you in your own land, and then you shall know that I am the Lord. I have spoken, and I will do it, declares the Lord." God's people are in exile due to their own disobedience. Their mood had become one of despair as their beloved city, Jerusalem, had not just come under attack and fallen, but it had been destroyed. The temple where God's presence once had reigned and ruled, and they could see the Shekinah glory, was in rubbles. It was torn apart. And so these exiles are without hope of restoration. And it seemed unlikely, just like it seemed unlikely the bones could be brought back to life. I mean, being exiles in a pagan land was to them a living death. Better off they would be in a cemetery. And all of these feelings are summed up in this passage in verse 11. Our bones are dried up and our hope is lost. We are indeed cut off. Remember the words of the psalmist in Psalm 137, 1-4. By the waters of Babylon, there we sat down and wept when we remembered Zion. On the willows there we hung up our lyres. For there our captors required of us songs, and our tormentors with mirth sang, "Sing one of the songs of Zion." How shall we sing the Lord's song in a foreign land? It's here that God, through Ezekiel, speaks words of hope. As is often true when a vision is had, the scenery suddenly changes. Ezekiel now sees Israel as buried in graves in exile. Of course, he's not actually writing to those who are literally dead, but those who are in exile, whose life is like being entombed in a cemetery. And God is promising, "Behold, I will open your graves and raise you from your graves, O my people, and I will bring you into the land of Israel." Though they had rejected him, God was still desirous of calling them my people. And he would bring them back to their own land. And they would be resurrected from the death of exile. And once again have the opportunity to become the mighty army of God. They would know that this had happened by the mighty word and the spirit of Yahweh, the only true and living God. What kind of love is this? Can you imagine the depth of love that God has for those who are his beloved? Have you ever stopped to consider how often Israel turned away from God and even boldly worshiped other gods in his temple? And yet he longed to restore them and call them his people. God has not changed. And he still longs for us who are his people to come into a relationship with him and be reconciled with him. I love 1 John 3:1. How great is the love that the Father has lavished upon us that we should be called children of God. And that is what we are. Some have considered this passage from Ezekiel as speaking of the final resurrection of the dead in the final age. But I don't believe that's the point that Ezekiel is making here. His vision and interpretation was initially to bring hope back to Israel, that they would know that he was God, they were God's people, and then it was not intended to teach the doctrine of bodily resurrection. But instead it was comparing their restoration to bringing back life to dry bones in hopes that they would see the power and the glory of the God that they had walked away from. They needed to accept that their exile was deserved because in essence they had chosen death in exile to covenant faithfulness with God. They had been warned repeatedly by the prophets of how God was going to deal with their hard-heartedness and their turning away from his commands and committing adultery with other gods. But hopefully this time of exile would wake them up to the reality of the consequences of their sin. And when God acted to miraculously set them free and restore them to life, they would see this as life coming up from death. The miracle of resurrection, and they would respond with gratefulness to the God who had shown such commitment and faithfulness to them. Ezekiel most likely would not have seen this vision in the fuller sense of God's story of redemption for the world. But as we've already seen, there is a correlation between God breathing life into the dry bones that had been given skin. They had been given flesh again, but there was no life in them. And God breathes into them in the same way in the book of Genesis that God breathes into the inanimate man, Adam, who was just dust until God breathed upon him. Christopher J.H. Wright, in his commentary on Ezekiel, points out the links between Israel and humanity are apparent. Israel had been called in the first place through Abraham to be a blessing to all the nations of the earth, and their election and redemption were for the sake of the rest of humanity. And likewise, therefore, just as their sin and punishment mirrored the fallenness of the whole race, so too their restoration would prefigure God's gracious purpose of redemption for humanity. Resurrection for Israel anticipated resurrection for all. We see the best representation of this story in Christ himself. On the very evening of his resurrection, he comes into a locked room, just comes through the door without opening it. And John 20:22 says, he breathed on them and said, "Receive the Holy Spirit." Now hear the Lord of life who has just risen from the bones of death himself, adopts the same posture as God the Father, by commanding the breath of the Spirit to come upon them, upon his disciples. And disciples would come to realize that what God had done through Jesus the Messiah was exactly what they had hoped that God would do for Israel. Everything that Israel and indeed all of creation had longed for was now accomplished for those who would believe in and follow him. Jews and Gentiles alike, but for those who reject him, for those who turn away from the word of the living God, it will be just like those dry bones in Ezekiel's vision. There'll be no hope. the same resurrecting power that had brought life to the dry bones in Ezekiel's vision and then brought life to the dead body of Jesus in the tomb was available to the ends of the earth. It's the same power that's available to us today. This hope of salvation and of bodily resurrection is ours because of what Christ has done. As we read this morning in Romans 8, 10 and 11, if Christ is in you, although the body is dead because of sin, the Spirit is life because of righteousness. If the Spirit of him who raised Jesus from the dead dwells in you, he who raised Christ Jesus from the dead will also give life to your mortal bodies through his Spirit who dwells in you. And last week we discussed how the Apostle John wrote his gospel as a testimony to the divinity of Jesus Christ as the Son of God. It was Jesus whom the Father had used in creation as the agent of creation to bring all things to pass. And he was the one that came down from heaven to put on flesh and become God incarnate. In John's gospel, Jesus demonstrates this power and this authority by healing the sick and casting out demons and teaching as one who had power and authority like they'd never seen before. Last week, we read of Jesus as the light of the world, bringing sight to a man born blind. And even those who were not following him had to admit that something like this had never happened before. And in today's gospel, we're reading Jesus hears that his friend Lazarus is very sick, and his sisters Mary and Martha sent for him to come. But Jesus, upon hearing of this, said, "This illness does not lead to death. It's for the glory of God, so that the Son of God may be glorified through it." He deliberately stays for two more days before he goes to Bethany in response to their request. And when he arrives, he's told that Lazarus has died, and he's already been in the tomb for 4 days. Why would he have waited an additional 2 days? Well, in actuality, by the time he hears of the illness, the messengers didn't know it, but Lazarus has already died. But Jesus decides to wait some more time. He knew what he was going to do in order for God to receive the glory. He needed to wait the additional time. Dr. Rod Whitaker, in his commentary on John's gospel, says this: Jesus arrives and finds that Lazarus has been in the tomb for 4 days. Burials normally took place on the day of the death, so he's been dead for 4 days. And for Jews, this probably signifies that Lazarus is clearly dead and beginning to decay. A later Jewish text that cites an authority from the early 3rd century AD says the mourners should continue to come to the tomb for 3 days because the dead person continues to be present. Mourning is at its height on the 3rd day, presumably because it's the last time the dead person would be present there. Bar Kappara taught, until 3 days after death, the soul keeps on returning to the grave, thinking that it will go back into the body. But when it sees that the facial features have become disfigured, it departs and abandons the body. Thus, the reference to the 4th day may be quite significant for setting the scene for another dramatic miracle. Jesus knew their tradition, and there will be no doubt about what he was going to do and where it came from. So upon arriving in Bethany, Mary and Martha professed to Jesus that if he had just been there, that their brother Lazarus would not have died. And he responds, "Martha, I am the resurrection and the life. Whoever believes in me, though he dies, yet shall he live, and everyone who lives and believes in me shall never die. Do you believe this?" And she said to him, "Yes, Lord, I believe that you are the Christ, the Son of the living God, who is coming into the world." And as Jesus and Mary and Martha and the crowd of mourners go to the tomb, Jesus requests that they roll the stone away. And of course, Mary replies, "Lord, look, he's been in there for 4 days. We roll that stone away, it's going to be an awful odor." And Jesus said, did I not tell you that if you believed, you would see the glory of God?" So let's read again verses 41 through 44. "And so they took away the stone, and Jesus lifted up his eyes and said, 'Father, I thank you that you have heard me. I knew that you always hear me, but I said this on account of the people standing around, that they may believe that you sent me. And when he had said these things, he cried out with a loud voice, Lazarus, come out! And the man who had died came out, his hands and feet bound with linen strips, and his face wrapped with a cloth. And Jesus said to them, unbind him and let him go. What Jesus was preparing to do was to further reveal that he indeed was the Messiah that they've been looking for. And this miracle should model the same power and authority as Ezekiel's vision in the Valley of the Dry Bones, when Yahweh demonstrated his power and his authority by speaking to those bones and they were raised up. And Jesus cries out for Lazarus. He too is crying out to a dead body, which made about as much sense as Ezekiel crying out to dead bones. And yet Lazarus comes out of the tomb alive, and they remove the grave clothes, just like God was wanting to do from Israel. Come back to me. I will raise you up. I will command my spirit to be upon you, and I will set you free. Oh, Israel, how I long to do that for you. This event, this story had very little to do with Lazarus needing to be restored to life again, because it was not that long before he dies again. The whole episode was to demonstrate that Jesus, who had the authority over sickness, over nature, over demonic forces, over every physical abnormality, now had authority over death as well. Clearly, he was the Son of God, whose voice could raise the dead. So what's our response to this story, or to the story of Ezekiel? Do we merely just tuck this information away in our minds in case the conversation comes up sometime? We can talk intelligently about it. Or do we ask God, are we curious as to what God wants to do through us because of this story? When Ezekiel spoke the words of Yahweh, the transformation of the dry bones began. And when he called on the Spirit of God to breathe upon them, they came alive. What does that sound like to you? Is it remotely reminiscent of the gospel? We speak the words of God, and we invite the Spirit and the power of God to attend the message. What if we who have received that word of God, what if we spoke that word of God? And those of us who have been indwelt by his Spirit because we have received Jesus, what if we chose to speak that word and call upon the Spirit of God to attend our words? You notice that Ezekiel didn't have to go take a class on how to raise up bones first. He just simply spoke the words that God had given him. We got a book. It's full of God's words. What about those around us who look alive? Maybe even some here this morning, but inside feel empty and dead. This word is for them. And it's for us who long to see the glory of God displayed in our midst. So there's three kinds of people here. Those that are just dead because of their sin. There are those who look like they're alive, like Miracle Max. Well, he's only mostly dead. But still they're dead inside. They long for that Spirit. And then there are those of us who say we long to see God move in power. God is inviting us to come alive, to speak to those who are dead and to those who wish they knew Jesus better. That should be who we are this morning. Let's pray and ask God to show us the answer to that question. In Jesus' name.